Jr., Mr. Mahassan.
Here.
Mr. Solander.
Here.
Mr. Klein.
Here.
Thank you, gentlemen, and Lee.
Thank you. We have a call. Let me begin by welcoming Terry Fry and Jessica Shackle, who are new to the engineering department. This is their first year in the zoning board, so we're here as well. Try to make this as painless as possible. Literally, Linda already beat me to it, but I assume everyone's turned off their smartphones and anything else that's going to make noises during the hearing this evening. And I see that we have a videographer in attendance, and I thank you for being at the side, Mr. Hoffman. I appreciate that. Before we begin this evening's agenda, let me explain the procedure that we'll follow this evening. It's the same one that we always do, and that is that we only have one application this evening, and that will be introduced by Jessica by reference to the application for variance. We will then entertain comments or argument, if you will, for anyone who wants to speak on behalf of the application. During that presentation, I will get questions from the board, and anybody else who wants to speak on behalf will be welcome to do so, after which we'll entertain comments from anyone who wants to speak in opposition to the application. And the same procedure will apply there, namely that questions may be posed by members of the board. I will then poll the members of the board and ask them for their comments about the application. We'll have a discussion about it, and then I'll entertain a motion to either approve the application for variance or to deny it. So that's generally how we're going to proceed. The first item on our agenda before we get to the application itself, however, are the what are styled as minutes from the July 26th meeting of this board. Just some background before we get to that point. For a number of years now, we've received a transcript in lieu of actual minutes. The transcript has been prepared pursuant to an ordinance of the City of North Canton, which requires a verbatim transcript of these proceedings be prepared and made available to council. And that's fine. That's not appropriate to say one way or the other, whether that's wise. But these really are not minutes. And so what I'm going to do this evening to break from prior practice is simply to entertain a motion to acknowledge receipt of the transcript that was prepared. Any certification of it is obviously up to whoever prepared it and not to us. And we'll acknowledge receipt of the transcript. And then I'm going to request for our next meeting that we receive a summary of the action taken by the board and the application on the application or applications at that time. Those will be minutes that we'll approve them and correct them at that time. So with that explanation of where we are procedurally, I will entertain a motion to acknowledge receipt of the transcript of the meeting of July
26, 2016.
I so move. Is there a second?
I second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Would you call the roll, please?
Mr. Solander.
I vote in favor of the motion, yes.
Mr. Mahassan.
Yes.
Mrs. Weaver.
Yes.
Mr. Klein.
Yes.
Motion, thank you, board.
Motion passed. Thank you very much. So the first and only item on our agenda this evening is an application for the use variance. Jessica or Linda, whoever is going to do this, would you please introduce yourself?
Before us this evening is case 243-16. The address of the property affected is 832 South Main Street, North Canton, Ohio, lot 920-1245. Its current zoning is GBA. It is owned by Kenneth E. Swickard, and he is asking for a variance to operate a bed and breakfast at this address. The code and section from which the variance is requested is code 1137.03, schedule of permitted uses.
Thank you. I assume there's someone here to speak on behalf of the application for the variance.
Well, actually, Mr. Swickard is going to speak,
okay.
But I'm here for support.
Okay, that's fine. I understand you're, just for, so everyone understands, when you want to speak on the record, please step up to the podium. If you haven't already done so, sign in, because we record our proceedings, and that will be easier for them who's speaking. Comments from the back of the room will be out of order and will not be accepted. So if you would please introduce yourself, and then your time, please.
Thank you. My name is Anna Gazarda.
Can you
You know what? I can give you my card.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We do not have a signing sheet bill.
We don't.
It's become ineffective, so we ask for
Do another.
Someone to say it and spell it.
That's right.
And then Mr. Swihart is going to be speaking.
Okay, go ahead.
Yes, I will.
Yeah, go ahead, sir.
E. Swihart, SWICK, NRZ. And along with my new right engine, we home 832 South Main Street. First off, I understand all of your volunteers, and I appreciate you doing what you're doing and taking time. As you know, in any large organization, the city is a large organization, 10% of people do 90% of the work, and you're part of that 10%. So I appreciate you taking time so that you can move forward and things like that. I'm a longtime North Canton resident. I've moved here in 1959. I spent 24 years in the military, came back, didn't intend to be from North Canton again, but find myself in North Canton again. And you're applying for a condition or a variance to use so we could use our century home as a bed and breakfast. I believe you probably all read our presentation.
Yes, yeah, just so you understand, we received a packet from the engineering department with your application, lots of information, including maps, your argument of counsel, and it's our practice and custom also to tour the property. We don't go in the property, but we all go and look at it and see. So there's a visualization of what we're dealing with here. So there's a lot of background already in place which you will not have to repeat.
Excellent. I would have been happy to give a tour.
Yeah, I'm sure you would.
Rather than take up any more of your time explaining why we want to do what we want to do, I would like to entertain any questions that you may have.
I have, the first question I have is, I understand from resources that I've seen, including online, that this bed and breakfast is already functioning as a bed and breakfast. Is that correct?
That is correct.
When did that start, sir?
On the 6th of June, around the 1st of June of last year. I had checked the GBA requirements and I didn't see anything about specific bed and breakfast, but I interpreted the motel and also the residential as being essentially the same thing. About 2 months later, a gentleman came by and introduced himself as being from Prevents and Ordinances, and we had a discussion. He said, well, we did your due diligence. However, you're in Canton, we can only put a bed and breakfast in areas of residential. And at that time, he said, don't worry about it. Don't lose any sleep. I'm going to help you through this. I prepared a various package within the first week and called to see what I could do to present. And I was told at that time that other things were being in the works, that were looking at changing ordinances. I was not told to do cease and desist. I was told to just be quiet, and I was also told to apply for an occupancy permit, which I did. And all I need for my occupancy permit for a bed and breakfast is the last fire inspection. That's it. I did everything that the city was the city's representative at that time, not necessarily the city, asked me to do. I was never told to cease and desist. And I would have immediately, but I was told just to keep going. Because the gentleman came, toured the facility, saw what we were doing. And so to answer your question, yes.
Was that Mr. Bowles?
Yes, sir.
Did you speak to anybody else in the city who came about this other than Mr. Bowles?
No, because my understanding is he was the one who was handling all that, and he was my point of contact. Didn't really necessarily want to go above and beyond him because he promised me that he had everything under control.
Okay, thank you. Mary, do you have a question?
I see two addresses at the home. Do you live upstairs and the bed and breakfast is on them?
Actually, there are three addresses.
Oh, three? Yes. I only saw 830 and 832.
And there's also 828, which is an efficiency apartment down behind in the back. 830 is an executive apartment on the second and third floor of the Century Home, and 832 occupies the entire, what would be ground level at Main Street portion of the home.
And that would be where the bed and breakfast would be.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, primarily in the front part of the Century Home.
And there's enough parking in the rear of the building to accommodate?
Yes, ma'am.
Bed and breakfast?
Yeah, that, my backyard is a concrete parking lot.
How many cars do you?
One, two, three, four, five. I think when I started this process before, they counted eight.
How many guest rooms do you have?
We have one that we operate right now. We have an overflow room that we put into use, but we like to just have one.
Okay. Because I was looking online and under, I was thinking it's hotels.com, so there were two guest rooms?
The apartment upstairs, when we initially started this with empty, we're going to use that as one of the rooms.
Okay.
It has since been leased, and so it's all closed off. You can't. It's easier to close it off than it is to take it off on the website.
Okay.
So it's not really there for rent.
You have a tenant up there, staying there with a lease?
Yes.
For a term, for a specified term?
Yes.
That's
a separate apartment, yeah.
Have you had, how many guests, or is somebody staying in the guest room tonight, or how much time do you have? Percentage-wise, is somebody usually staying in that guest bedroom down the stairs?
Well, we, in Pocho Morelli, which is the suite that we have up front in the Century Home, which is our primary area that we use, we average between anywhere from 8 to 15 bookings a month, depending on the month. We close down because the time is maybe just a little bit.
Does the guest room have kitchen facilities?
No, sir.
Does it have cooking facilities?
No, sir.
There, the website says something about a kitchenette. Is that outside?
That's just, it's probably a misnomer calling a kitchenette. It's a refrigerator and microwave.
Okay. I can see a picture of an oven and a dining room table. I can show you some pictures.
Well, some of that may be back in the kitchen. We offer what's called a chef's table.
Okay.
Where they can come back into the kitchen and prepare the meals for them at the table.
Okay.
And so some of those photos may be representative of the kitchen area.
And is that the lounge? You have like a common lounge area too? Would that be the lounge area?
Well, up front, in the suite area, they have a bedroom, a bathroom. Have a sitting area in front of the fireplace, and they have also a small area where we have a table where we can feed them if they choose to eat en suite. And they also have a Four Seasons room up front. So that's their whole area. They have no other reason to come back any back. If we were to use the overflow room, they would have access to a common area again.
So the layout, I'm just trying to get the layout right. So this kitchen, this oven I'm looking at is not, there's a room where they sleep. That's a separate, that's closed off, they can lock it off.
Yes.
Wire through it. And then that's a separate, completely different room is where this oven is. And
I'm not sure the picture that you're looking at. We have a
yeah, sure.
See what you're talking about.
Yeah. It's called a comfort suite. That's the one upstairs.
That's the one that's
okay.
Yeah, that should actually, we're trying to get that off the website.
That is, now that's an apartment now.
That's an apartment. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I guess we're,
okay. Is there any chance that upstairs apartment will become a guest room and a bed and breakfast down the road?
That's not the plan, no.
Okay.
No, it's not suited for that, and it would be too much work to do that.
Well, the reason I ask is because the conditional use regulations say you're not allowed to have kitchenettes and or kitchen equipment in a guest bedroom or a guest room in a bed and breakfast. That has to be in an area. The other thing the reg says there has to be a common lounge area. So I'm trying to, that's the other question I have, is there like a common lounge that's separate from any guest room?
not sure how you would describe that as a common lounge area. They have, they could come into the back if they need to, but they have their own lounge area as part of the suite.
The one room?
Yes.
A suite?
Okay, yeah. It's actually somewhere in the neighborhood for probably about 600 to 700 square feet.
So the plan for the indefinite future is to have just one room for the bed and breakfast?
Yes, sir, with an overflow room for those people who want to come with their family.
Okay.
Because we have one other bedroom that has an attached bathroom, and that's it. Anything else in that area, we have to do some major renovations, put in another bathroom. We're not willing to do that. We're only interested in just that one level of the facility and eating bed and breakfast.
Okay. Those, I don't have any other questions right now. Thanks.
All right.
You mentioned that they're serve food.
Yes, sir.
Correct. Where do you serve the food? At the rooms?
They have a choice. I'm sorry to interrupt. They have a choice between, we have it so we can serve them up in their suite if they want up front, or at the chef's table, which is a place back in the kitchen where they can sit and watch us prepare the food. Most people go back there.
So outside of serving the meals, are they permitted to use that chef's table as that might very well serve as that common lounge area? Are they permitted to congregate there during the day?
That's been known to happen. Yeah, we established a pretty good relationship with our guests.
So you must have more than one guest there at the chef tables if both of the rooms for the guests that you have, they very well could be at that chef's table, i.e. common lounge, and
correct.
Very well could be permitted to be there.
Correct.
I think for me, the biggest criteria and the most difficult threshold for you to reach for a variance, for a use variance, is the first one that we have on our criteria. It states that you have to demonstrate by clear and convincing evidence that property cannot be put to any economically viable use under any of the permitted uses in the zoning district for which it's located. So I think if any of those would hold up the board, perhaps it would be that one. So could you touch on that for them?
Sure. Ms. Arco.
Stand up here, please. You'll be able to answer the factual part of that a little bit more. We did address this in the application that we submitted a little bit, and we do understand what that threshold is, which I did not see it, and correct me if I'm wrong, necessarily defined within the zoning code in North Canton for unnecessary hardship, but the uniqueness of this particular building that has been there since the beginning of 1900s really doesn't lend itself in that area of the house to operate a business. I mean, it's really a house. he is leasing those upper utility
the apartment
upstairs, right? But as far as what's going on downstairs, which does have a different address, there's really no other viable business that he's able to run out of that.
Correct. We couldn't put retail in there because we don't have a parking. We don't have enough parking for retail. This is about the only thing. We couldn't use it as another apartment without putting in a kitchen. And that's an enormous expense as well. This is the only thing that we could come up with, and plus it's a passion of ours as well.
Okay, although it's not mentioned in the ordinance, the Supreme Court defines unnecessary hardship, and it says what we're
results when it's not economically feasible to put the property to a permitted use under its present zoning classifications due to characteristics unique to the property. And I think that is important from what you stated about how it is set up, that I think another aspect, if you will, if you could touch on the way the property was set up when you purchased it, which another one of those criteria is that you haven't created this condition and then asked for a variance for that variance.
That's correct. When I purchased the property from my father, who originally purchased the Century Home back in the mid-80s and then built on the addition that is in back right now, because his intent was to have a business downstairs and for my mother and he to live, him to live on where we're living now, and then to rent out the upstairs apartment for additional income. That was the way the property was when I bought it. It was already set up with the residential section on the middle floor, the apartment upstairs, and the business downstairs. So when we bought it that way, I bought it that way. I haven't changed anything. That's what I'm trying to do right now.
Can I ask Mr. Fox?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Brian, any questions?
I have nothing.
I don't have any further questions at this point. Unless you have anything else you'd like to present, we'll entertain other comments on the application.
No, we would just like to reiterate the fact that really it's a very unique situation there with the residential areas and really abutting both sides of the property, which is where bed and breakfast could be a conditional use in North Canton. It's located, you wouldn't have to change anything, doesn't change the congestion for either the residential area or the business area. And just to consider what a valuable asset that we think that this would be for North Canton.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Carter. Is there anybody else here this evening who wants to speak on behalf of the application? Okay, is there anybody who wants to speak in opposition to the
application? Mr. Chair, I would add that staff did receive one phone call from an adjacent property owner that received the mailing. They asked a couple of questions about what was going on. We explained that they were requesting a variance for a bed and breakfast. And as close as I can, the phone caller said, well, I have no concerns about that. They run a tight ship down there. That was the expressed, I'm just relaying that little bit of information to, you can use it as you may.
Okay. Well, we're not a court of law, so I guess hearsay people. thank you for adding that for us. Is there anyone who wants to speak on behalf of the application? Is there anyone who wants to speak in opposition to the application? Mr. Osborne, would you like to step forward, please, and identify yourself for the record?
Chuck Osborne, 307 Frederick Street, South East, North Canton, Ohio. I'm not here to really pro or con on the issue, but there's something I think needs to be clarified here. I heard four addresses described. What little knowledge I've come by here in the last few days, I've been told there are actually two apartments in addition to the property owner living there. So there's three families living there, and then you have the two B&Bs. There's also a driveway that comes in off of Main Street, which may impact what somebody might calculate for parking space. And I would think that that driveway area would need to be maintained for ingress and egress, although you can also go out the rear on the alley. Anyway, I want to just pick up what Mrs. Wheeler said about parking. You've got three families that live there, plus whoever comes and goes in the two B&Bs. So I just, in the interest of full understanding of the situation, two apartments, plus the residence of the homeowner, and then the two B&Bs. That's what you're looking at.
No,
sir.
Any questions from Mr. Osborne? There being none, thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Counsel, would you want to respond to that in any way? Please step up immediately.
Well, I would just say, I mean, that's sort of speculation. I mean, anybody who bought, I suppose, a driveway, I don't think that that's really an issue that needs to be addressed. And as far as the parking, you know, you did hear Mr. Swickard explain how it has been running for a little bit of time in our town and issues with parking in the last year.
Okay, how many spots do you have available?
Eight.
Total?
Yes, I had some.
If you're considering all of the addresses?
The three addresses, well, let's see, there's, we have the 1, 2, 3, 4. You see, you need one parking space for each B&B room. So that's two. Two for each apartment. So that's six, and then two for our residents, and that's eight.
So that's what you have available?
Correct.
Today?
Correct.
Okay.
And I would like to clarify very quickly, I do think Mr. Osborne mischaracterized the two bed and breakfasts, and you did hear Mr. Swickard's testimony about the fact that it's really one, there's an overflow room if somebody has
some
child
family
or something.
Sure. Come with
and they need a little extra, but that wouldn't necessarily have anything to do with parking.
I mean, just for everybody's clarification, bed and breakfast, our rates stay one space per guest room plus requirement for dwelling unit. So it sounds like we're in the corner.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, what I would like to do then, if there's no one else that's speaking in opposition to the application, is to entertain a motion one way or the other to approve the application or deny it, and then we have a discussion as to our various positions with respect to the motion. So I would entertain the mayor and
I move that we approve the request.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, it's moved and second, and let's have a discussion. And I'll kick it off myself by pointing out much of what I've heard in terms of the logistics and the attributes of the property being suitable for a B&B or fall within the ordinances is interesting, but I don't think it goes to the point of whether a variance should be waived or not. I don't think that's the criteria. And I do not believe the economic benefit to the city of North Canton is germane to the issue, because it's not the financial benefit to the city is not the basis for granting a variance. I don't doubt the sincerity of that or the validity of it, but that's really not the basis for granting a variance. I'd also like to say that when I first became aware that this had been in operation for more than a year, I was a little disturbed by that, because we have consistently frowned upon people who violate the ordinances and then approach us and ask us to bless what they've been doing. But under these circumstances, I believe the testimony for the presentation that the applicant was acting in good faith with a representative from the city essentially telling him not to cease what he was doing. And so that I don't find it disqualifying in this particular situation. However, having said that, I don't think that the criteria for granting the variance has been met. I don't think, as Mr. Fox pointed out, the very first hurdle, and that's whether there cannot be any other economically viable use of the property available to the applicant. That's been that. I think this is a situation, in my own opinion anyway, that where City Council simply needs to amend the schedule of permitted uses in this particular general business district to reflect the allowance of a bed and breakfast. And I think that's where the decision lies. I think it's a legislative decision and not one for this board. That's my take on the matter. Right?
I don't know that issue.
Okay.
You know, I guess I have a different opinion on that. I do find it's a unique situation. I'm a little. I do wonder what else can be done.
running a legitimate bed and breakfast. They do appear to be in compliance with the conditional use permit. I do agree that city council needs to take a look at the zoning of this area, and maybe all along Main Street where we have residences that are zoned, might be zoned this way. But in the meantime, and I also think, I was also concerned about the fact that this was operated for a long time in violation, but given the circumstances, it seems like it was a reasonable reliance on the part of the applicant. So for those reasons, I would probably, I'm still trying to decide here whether this is a legislative issue or not, but I'm thinking this may be a unique situation.
Thank you, Mary.
Did you do any checking with the city before you started operation, before Tim came and talked to you? I mean, did you think you were in violation?
No, I checked your ordinances, and I didn't see anything on bed and breakfast anywhere. And when they looked at general business A, it said hotel and motel. I was not able to think that that also included bed and breakfast. I didn't know now, but because of another application that I applied for, the hotel has to have at least five rooms. So I claimed ignorance. No, I didn't approach anybody else because I thought I had a good word. This is correct. That was an error.
And then Mr. Fox got word.
Mr. Bowles.
Yes, Mr.
Bowles. I knew you were going to check in.
I'm sorry.
No,
Mr. Bowles.
Yes, it was Mr. Bowles. And I frequently call him to find out what's going on and see what I can do.
And Mr. Swicker, during this time that you were working with Mr. Bowles, was there some times where you pulled some permits for some work to be done, to be the work being verified by the permits office along the way to get you to that stage?
Oh, yes.
I did pull some permits?
Yes, I officially applied for an occupancy permit for a bed and breakfast, and part of that had to have a rather expensive fire alarm system put in, and so we just had to help for that.
So you've had some inspections along the lines for those?
Yes, we have. Like I said, the fire alarm system is up and ready to be inspected for the occupancy permit. However, it doesn't make sense to do that until I find out if we can continue with that.
Well, I was asking that to help corroborate that you were working with the permits department,
and
you had them look at the situation that you had there with the property, and there were some recommendations made, and you have incurred some finances in bringing it about to the state that you believe it was necessary for that.
Correct.
The approval of the
I invested money to meet the requirements.
Okay. So there was a fire inspection and some work that needed to be done to reach that?
Correct.
Can you describe some of the work that you had done in furtherance of that?
Yes. We had a big fire alarm system put in that would, because it's a commercial building, it had to have a unique fire alarm system. In other words, I had to have a fire alarm system that if one fire alarm went off anywhere in the building, that all fire alarms went off so that people upstairs and downstairs could get out. Last count, I don't know, 15 fire alarms, 15 smoke detectors, because there has to be one in each bedroom and then one within 13 feet of the building. So it was an extensive project.
And just so we're clear on this, if this board would grant the variance for the B&B, are you aware, and it's not fair to ask Mr. Fry, this right now is kind of on the spot, but are there other criteria that you would be required to have completed before the permits department, with this granted variance, would be required to complete? I imagine they would start with an inspection and help with that, but if they relayed any information to you.
I have already had them come out and inspect for for the occupancy permit, and the only thing that was deficient was the fire alarm.
Right.
So they have already been out to inspect, and I've been approved in all areas except for the fire.
The variance for the B&B, for the use in that area.
Correct.
A GBA.
You have a full certificate of occupancy for that property as a business use, as a bed and breakfast, is that correct?
No, I do not. I do not. They suggested, Mr. Bolt suggested that I get an occupancy permit for a bed and breakfast. I have not gotten that occupancy permit because I'm not in code, and but I have done everything that was required of me to obtain the occupancy permit, should I have the opportunity to.
So they could, if indeed they voted in favor of this variance, the variance could be contingent upon obtaining the occupancy rating.
I think that's a given.
Yeah.
It wouldn't be contingent when you did that. You still have to comply with whatever the code says.
Yes, sir.
One question is, we're still in the use, in the use issue only. So, is there any other questions?
Mr. Klein, are you saying that this decision is not for this board?
No, this decision on the use is for this board, the application for a variance on use. But subsequent to that, he will still have to meet the criteria of the code to run the B&B. And I think that's pretty clear now.
Yeah, because you haven't had anyone stay at the B&B part of the building yet.
I know we have.
Yeah.
We've been to shut down operation.
We shut down when you didn't have an occupancy.
No, we were told to continue operation.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah. And that was part of this earlier presentation.
Yeah.
And that's,
yeah. Okay. Yeah.
But the first thing I did when I was told to do the occupancy, because our number one priority is the safety of our guests. And so we immediately set out to meet that occupancy permit requirement, which we do except for the actual final inspection.
Does, one more question for me, does the City of North Canton have or issue temporary certificates of occupancy?
Temporary.
A condition?
I don't think so. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, I think it's time to call the question. The motion is to grant the application for variance to permit the use of the property as a B&B, subject, of course, to otherwise compliance with code. So, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. Zolliver?
I vote in favor.
Mr. Mahalson?
Yes.
Mrs. Weaver?
Yes.
Mr. Klein?
No.
Thank you,
Walter. Thank you. The application for variance was granted.
Thank you.
And you can work with the permit department to complete the process. There being nothing else on